Chihuahua.
It's the circle of life.
Who doesn't know that opening line of the song? Yeah, that's the original soundtrack of a worldwide phenomenon Disney's animation, The Lion King. What's the theory behind the making of that well-known animation? We are gonna find it out more. Welcome back to Theory of Everything. This program will entertain you with our own take on various number of popular culture. From the making of well-known Korean series Squid Game, to how a world-class brand's logo is being named. Furthermore, we may also talk about your favorite books, video games, products, and perhaps the story of your topless artist of all time. So, go grab your popcorn now, and happy binge-watching! Today, we're going to breaking down our theory on The Lion King, one of the most popular animation films back in the 90s. We will tell you about the story behind its creation, and even their message that everyone gets wrong. First, do you know that The Lion King is related to the infamous Hitler? A Nazi German dictator that reigned over Germany from 1933 until his death in 1945? One of the most popular scenes in The Lion King was when the evil lion Scar sings "Be Prepared." It tells a story of how Scar planned to kill Mufasa and his son Simba, to reign over the Pride Rock and became king for the entire Pride Lands. On an article from Entertainment Weekly in 1994, the director stated that for the Be Prepared scene, they ran with the concept and worked up a Triumph of the Will-style mock Nuremberg rally. For example, the goose-stepping soldiers in Triumph of the Will marched in a formation through Nazi Germany, inspired the group of hyenas in Be Prepared scene to walk and making a similar formation. The character of Scar itself was also loosely based on King Claudius, the antagonist character of William Shakespeare's Hamlet, and additionally inspired by the villainy and tyranny of Adolf Hitler. On Be Prepared scene, Scar is also elevated for the majority of the sequence, standing on a cliff overlooking his army. This is very similar to how Hitler is portrayed in much Triumph of the Will. Even though the scene was depicted in the most political way, it doesn't make the audience falter. Instead, it was considered by many as the best villain song scenes in the entire Disney history. Continue on, although The Lion King was met with near universal praise when it first released, the film still drew some controversy. Hyena's characters in the film regarded by many as a depiction of a group of minorities and spark of racism issues for the film. The hyenas live in a shadowy corner of the Pride Land, exiled from the well-privileged Pride Land's inhabitants. It is similar to the group of minorities that live in the rural areas far from privileged neighborhoods in the US. The cast of voice actors for these characters is also strengthened the theory.
I don't think so! Ooh, that violates so many laws of nature!
An African-American actress, Whoopi Goldberg, cast it to voice Chansey, and Cheech Marin, a Mexican-American actor, voiced as Banzai. They were both played them as low-life gangsters and reprobates who speak in slang.
Man, I just gotta get me some breakfast, and I feel like I got a hole in my stomach.
Their accents, regarded by critics, instantly demonized the character. Furthermore, the evil lion Scar, voiced by an English actor Jeremy Irons, with his British accent acted as the boss, subjugates the destitute hyenas as his servants.
I see.
Now that's power.
Tell me about it.
I'm surrounded by idiots.
Of course, this theory is still arguably right. As in an interview, a spokeswoman from Disney stated that it's only a story. It's fiction, so there's no need to talk about racism issues in the film. Eventually, it is up to us, the audience, to build the perspective whether the film depicted the issue of racism or not. The other controversy theories that circulates around the film is about plagiarism. Certain elements of the films were thought to bear a resemblance to Osamu Tezuka's 1960s Japanese anime television series, Kimba the White Lion. With some similarities between a number of characters and various individual scenes. The similarities are and not limited to. Both are coming-of-age stories centering on an African lion cub, and both cubs' father are murdered in the first act. Kimba includes several human characters in addition to animals, and focus on the conflicts between encroaching civilization and nature. On the other hand, The Lion King is merely a fable story. In The Lion King, the main villain is an evil lion named Scar who has a black mane and a scar over his left eye. In Kimba, the main villain is an evil lion named Clow who has a black mane and a scar in the place of his left eye. The similarities doesn't end for the main characters. For the supporting roles, Simba has Rafiki who depicted as a mandrill that always giving his advice as a mentor. Kimba is also has Buzara, a mandrill that always giving some advice to Kimba. The strongest evidence that Disney artists are borrowing Osamu Tezuka's ideas is the image of an early piece of concept art for The Lion King. There is an image that appears to show Simba as a white lion. Isn't that quite obvious? Even though The Lion King directors denied all of the plagiarism theories, stating that no one in the production team at the time were knowing anything about Osamu Tezuka nor his TV series Kimba the White Lion, maybe one day Disney's company should make an official statement about his recurring theory of plagiarism. For now on, let us just wait for when the truth will be unfold. Moving on to other controversies. Who doesn't know about Simba's best friends Timon and Pumbaa? The two characters depicted as a meerkat and a warthog that always goes along the way Simba's journey in the Bright Lands. One of the most popular taglines from them is Hakuna Matata. Hakuna Matata. To that certain point, many of us might be know about their lively characters. But have you ever heard a theory that says they are a couple? Oops! I know. Some of you must be surprised about the news. In its 1994 animation version of The Lion King, Timon is voiced by an openly gay actor Nathan Lane, and Pumbaa voiced by Ernie Sabella. In an interview held by the New York Times, June 12, 1994, Sabella and Lane stated that Timon and Pumbaa are the first homosexual Disney characters ever come to the screen. On its live-action or CGI remake of The Lion King that released in 2019, Jon Favreau as the director kept the tradition of Timon played by a gay actor. It was Billy Eichner, an Emmy-nominated Billy on the Street star. This decision put a more firm speculation that Timon purposely made as a gay character. In addition, there were also theories stated that Scar is a queer-coded character too. Monique Jones, a US journalist, noted on her blog that Scar contrasts with brother Mufasa in many ways. Mufasa is burly, deep-voiced, and masculine. Scar is lighter and is given to affect mannerisms and phrases, like, "Oh, I shall practice my curtsy." Also, Scar has no mane, which many fans have read into a signal. Do you think that they are queer to a certain degree? I'll keep the questions for you to answer. And as for now, let's we move on to another theory. In the film, little Simba is taken under Timon and Pumbaa's wing, but that means a change in eating habits. No more tasty antelope. Instead, it's a diet of slimy but satisfying crops. However, is that even possible if a lion cub live if it's just a diet made up entirely of insects? Lion experts and conservationist Dr. Craig Packer also once said there's simply no way that a lion could live on an eating box alone. Simba, it's a bucket load of termites, but looks like he's benched 500 in the gym. Maybe he's a fan of the protein shake. As we all know, The Lion King indeed is a fable. It is a story told by the production team behind the screen. Any flaws and disorientation about the real life and its story might occur undoubtedly. Have you ever watched The Lion King before? If not, do you mind to watch the film now? Leave your comment and don't forget to give us the answer. Coming up next, we still have plenty other theories for you to break down. So, stay tuned! Welcome back to Theory of Everything. This program will entertain you with our own take on various popular cultures that flooded our senses from the moment we open our eyes until the moment we lay at night. It'll be about your favorite song, video games, products, comic books, and even your favorite shows. It will be impossible to talk about popular Korean shows without mentioning the phenomenon one, which was The Squid Game. Since the series became popular around the world, that leaves a lot of unanswered questions behind. In this episode, we will highlight some of their conspiracy theories with some possible explanations. Before we go any further, let us remind you about the story plot. Squid Games is the wildly successful Netflix show set in South Korea in which people who are in a desperate situation financially are recruited by a shadowy organization to participate in a macabre contest with life or death stake. If that premise sounds familiar, it should be, as it is a part of subgenre of storytelling known as a survival drama and has certain similarities with films such as Battle Royale, The Hunger Games, and The Running Man. However, Squid Game is pointed to by someone as bearing a little too much of a resemblance to one film by Takashi Miike in 2014 named As the Gods Will. This plagiarism controversy is retained in certain similarities that Squid Game has to the Japanese film. For instance, it follows characters that are forced to play various games that will kill them if they lose. The high school characters even play a variation on red light and green light as the first game. In addition, some very familiar with both properties claim there are some eerily similar shots as well. Despite some similarities, the claim that Squid Game is a rip-off doesn't hold much water upon close scrutiny. However, for one thing, the contestants in Squid Game are participating voluntarily. Secondly, although both movies center around deadly childhood games, the forces behind them are different, as the God's Will has deities orchestrating the proceedings, rather than reclusive and malevolent billionaires as part of a secret organization. And finally, Squid Game creator Hwang Dong-hyo, who denies the plagiarism allegations, made a statement that he began working on a Squid Game back in 2009. Even though it took nearly a decade for it to find a home on Netflix and be made, that is why Dong-hyo has repeatedly denied Squid Game plagiarism claims. Other than allegations of plagiarism, Squid Game's often associated with North Korea leader Kim Jong-un. From death threats to North Koreans watching the Squid Games and twisting facts about the dark truth of South Korea as slaves to the capitalist system. The story begins in November 2021. North Korea has sentenced to death a man who smuggled and sold copies of Squid Game. After authorities caught 7 high school students watching the Korean language global hit show, the smuggler is said to have brought a copy of Squid Game into North Korea back from China and sold USB flash drives containing the series. Sources say his sentence will be carried out by firing squad. A student who bowed a drive received a life sentence, while six others who watched the show have been sentenced to 5 years of hard labor, and teachers and school administrators have been fired and faced punishment to work in remote mines or themselves. In the second week of November 2021, the copies of the violent drama had arrived in the reclusive country despite the best efforts of authorities to keep out foreign media. They began spreading among the people on flash drives and SD cards. The show's dystopian world in which marginalized people are pitted against one another in traditional children's games for huge cash prizes, and losing players are put to death, resonates with North Koreans in risky occupations and insecure positions. The arrest of the seven students marked the first time that the government is applying the newly passed law on the elimination of reactionary thought and culture in a case involving minors. The law was promulgated in 2020, carries a maximum penalty of death for watching, keeping, or disturbing media from capitalist countries, particularly from South Korea and the US. On the other hand, besides North Korea's brutal reaction to the Squid Game serial, their Supreme Leader Kim Jong-un and other officials are probably thrilled about the release of this hit show. According to the experts, North Korean officials must be happy about Squid Game's release because the show has underscored how ultra-competitive capitalism has entirely conquered, and it also exerts negative influence over the common people. In an interview with the New York Post, Michael Madden, a non-resident fellow at US Best think tank the Stimson Center, say, "Kim's got to be thrilled at how South Korea is being depicted to the world. He's always railing about the influence of the West and consumerism and of South Korean and American society. He's got to be loving Squid Game." Meanwhile, another political expert and author of Losing South Korea, Gordon Chang, said that series such as Squid Game and Oscar-winning films such as Parasite undermine the faith that South Koreans have in their own government. Simultaneously, he suggested that such shows and movies add a certain appeal to the pledges of North Korea's Communist Party to an extent that some people favor reunification with the North. Well, we will going more deeper to the other interesting theory of Squid Games which will surprising you, or maybe bringing more question and theory in your head. You will find out after this one, if you dare to not go anywhere. Welcome back to Theory of Everything. This program will entertain you with our own take on various popular cultures that leave many questions on our mind and created many theories with the all possibilities. Squid Game has prompted many fan theories, which things that happen a lot to the most greatest show in the world, like Squid Games. In a previous video, we already talked about the controversy theories of the series. Right now, we will going more deeper in the other fun fact that will blowing your mind. All of us must be agreed that Squid Games has so many reasons to become the most successful and popular shows in the world. One of that is the original story, which is full of very strong and bloody scenes. As the days go by, more details about this fiction will be known, which came to the streaming platform to win the applause of the viewers. Now, the story behind the scary doll has been revealed. At the beginning of the Squid Game, we see how the protagonist of the series is recruited to join the game. Thus, he receives a mysterious card that has a circle, triangle, and square drawn on the front. But on the back, we see that there is a number. In the event that he decides to participate, the character must communicate with Sadeline. In the first episode of the Squid Game, we see how the participants must face a doll that acts as an executioner. When the doll turns her back on them and sings the song "Let's Play Move Green Line," players will have to advance to reach the red line at the end and cross it. But if the doll turns and someone moves, they will be eliminated from the game by being killed in cold blood. As expected, this doll generated a lot of buzz on social media, and many people wonder if there's a story behind it. And yes, the doll from Squid Game really exists. Situated at the entrance of a carriage museum in Jincheon County in Chungcheongbuk-do, just a few hours north of Seoul. It was borrowed for filming and immediately returned to the museum to be shown to the public. However, the carriage museum, also known as Machalan, wrote on its website that the large cordless puppet standing at 3 meters is under a private archiving process, just as creepy as Annabelle and Chucky. The giant doll condemning players to death with laser eyes and automatic snipers had many talking about its role in the series. Returned with other hand likely caused by an accident in transportation, it's now destined to the darkness of a warehouse. But the story of the giant doll in Squid Game becomes even more interesting when we discover its origins. Confirmed in an interview for Netflix Korea by actress Jung Hoyeon, that plays the role of Kang Sepyo, with a peach-colored face, perfectly tied hair split into two low pigtails, a dress above the knee, and a pair of high socks. The character references one of the most famous figures for young students in South Korea, named Young-hee. As the best friend of fellow adventurer Chul-so, she's the main character in a series of textbooks widely used in the 70s and 80s around the nation. Armor Core aside, the Squid Game doll taken from an illustration for kids has quickly become a warning symbol. If you realize, a lot of movies and stories that portrayals of South Korean inequality have captivated international audience. Yet Squid Game raises the bar by shining a light on the plight of marginalized group rarely featured in South Korean film and television. Its characters include migrant workers, North Korean defectors, divorcees, the long-term unemployed, and those with mental health issues. It is often overlooked that South Korea is now an increasingly diverse nation with over 2 million foreign residents and many more citizens with migrant heritage, such as naturalized marriage migrants and their multi-ethnic children. Since the 1990s, small and medium enterprises have relied on migrant workers to fill jobs that South Koreans no longer want. But migrant workers have no path to permanent residency or citizenship, having to leave South Korea after 4 years and 11 months or else remain illegally. Migrant workers face discrimination and exploitation, with numerous cases of workers not being paid or severely injured as depicted in the Squid Game. North Korean defectors are another group of stigmatized in South Korea. Defectors are marked as different by their accents, lack of education, and limited work experience. Integrating into South Korea is challenging, with cases of defectors even starving to death. Many defectors struggle to make ends meet, prompting some try to return to North Korea. Squid Game gives viewers a glimpse of the plight of defectors and migrants, but the depiction of subjugation and racial hierarchy is lost in translation. The migrant worker character Ali constantly refers to Korean males as Sajongni, used an honorific form of Korean language, and in several instances bows down to the South Korean characters, signifying they are his superior. South Korean characters use informal and non-verbal language to signify that Ali is their junior. Ali's deference to South Korean men, despite being taken advantage of, reflects deep-rooted societal discrimination and hierarchy between ethnic South Koreans and migrant workers. When a South Korean character lends Ali a small sum of money for public transport and later suggests he use a term of affection, Ali forgets his natural distrust and warmness towards South Koreans only to finally be betrayed. Ali's story reflects the thousands of cases of abuse of migrant wives and workers at the hands of those they should be able to trust, hence their husbands, in-law families, and employers. The female North Korean defector character Sebyeok is distrustful of South Koreans. Rather than being deferential, she is guarded and maintains distance as a survival mechanism. Defectors must place their trust in the hands of others to make the dangerous journey to South Korea, but many are instead trafficked into prostitution or forced marriage in China. Squid Game not only deals with poor minorities, but also features characters from across the spectrum of South Korean society, including a doctor, pastor, and financial professional. While South Korea's economy was once hailed as a miracle success for achieving equitable growth, today, many are in a precarious situation. By some estimates, almost half of the South Korean workforce are employed in non-regular or temporary jobs, lacking job security and access to a pension scheme. Many of these workers do not have a safety net and take on debts to meet basic expense. Even those with good jobs may carry high levels of debt due to unaffordable house prices and living expenses. With South Korea's household debt rising sharply during the COVID-19 pandemic, many are only one job loss, business failure, or personal tragedy away from financial hardship. Financial hardship is what unites all the contestants in Squid Game, as is their willingness to risk their life for a life-changing cash reward. This trope has been done before many times in South Korean productions. But what separates Squid Games from others is the relatability of the characters. Squid Game accurately depicts the lived reality that in modern South Korea, very few are safe from falling into poverty and desperation. Not only in the character, the portrait of society hierarchy also shows in their symbols. The first major symbol is the Squid Game logo itself. The rectangle represents the masses, while the triangle on top represents the wealthy who control the masses. The bottom circle represents the people in extreme poverty and debt. Last one is the top triangle that represents the elite who control the world. This perfectly represents the Squid Game philosophy. In fact, one of the games involves players on a field the same shape as the logo. In this game, the goal is to start at the bottom circle and make it to the top circle. Similarly to how the winner of all the 6 games goes from extreme poverty to being extremely wealthy. A second symbolic moment is after the players vote to end the game. At any point, players are allowed to have a vote on whether to end the game or not is needed agreement from the majority of players. However, players had the option to return if they wished. Many players come to the conclusion that they could not continue living in the extreme debt and that playing was the only option. Consequently, 93 of the players returned. The potential to live an economically stable life was enough to convince the vast majority of players to risk their lives in the Squid Games. In many ways, this represents the capitalist society we lived in. Just like the players had the choice to play the game or not, poor people have a choice as well. They can either agree to work and earn a subsistence wage, or they can live in severe poverty without source of income. The message in Squid Game is that the choice people make to work is far from voluntary. That's it! A glitch of controversy and conspiracy theory behind one of the famous shows in the history. As conclusion, Squid Game's just another example of Korea's penchant for ultra-violent fictions like the films Old Boy and The Man from Nowhere. At another level, it's a grim tale about the challenge of life in Korea today. What do you think, guys? Make sure to give us your thought about other Squid Game's 101 theory. See you later!